You're listening to the audio production of Master Mentors, Volume 2, 30 Transformative Insights from Our Greatest Minds by Scott Jeffrey Miller, published by HarperCollins Leadership and read by the author. Please note that you may download an accompanying PDF that provides enhanced materials for this audiobook. To download the PDF, please visit harperfocusaudio.com.
Introduction. With some bravado, I declared in Master Mentors Volume 1 that I would be writing Master Mentors Volume 2 and beyond. And while everyone has a right to sit down and author a book, getting it published by a reputable publisher is not a right, but a privilege. It only happens if an editor and their team choose to invest in your work and have the confidence your book will be well received and actually sell, and sell a lot. Yes, you can self-publish, and I wish anyone exploring that route great success as they navigate the inevitable challenges that follow. Caveat emptor. Publishing is a tough business. If a book doesn't sell well, the author rarely gets a second chance. The fact that you're listening to the introduction to Master Mentors Volume 2 should tell you that Volume 1 sold very well, but more importantly, confirmed that large numbers of listeners benefited from a collection of transformational insights vetted through my numerous interviews on FranklinCovey's On Leadership with Scott Miller podcast. Since the publishing of the first book in this series, I've been privileged to speak to nearly 100 live, in-person, or virtual audiences and found increasing validation that the power of just one transformational insight can be life-changing, let alone 30. Master Mentors Volume 1 has since been translated into many foreign languages, finding continued relevance to readers around the globe. I think much of this momentum stems from the fact that our successes, personally and professionally, are often because of the mentors we've had who have helped us navigate the obstacles and opportunities that pop up along our unique life journeys. Sometimes we have a formal relationship with such mentors in which our roles are clearly defined and there's a distinct beginning and end. More frequently, we experience mentors by what they say, the experiences they share, how they behave, and what they create, which means the most impactful mentors are often at arm's length. An author whose book we absorb, podcaster whose episodes we devour, a radio host, a keynote speaker, a historical figure, or someone in the public eye. However we draw upon their wisdom, we admire them and model our lives after them. It seems to me such informal mentorship is increasingly the case if we delve into those whom we strive to use as models in our lives. It certainly is for me. Case in point, Bruce Williams, the most influential mentor in my life. I've never met Bruce, and he never knew me. When I was growing up in Central Florida in the 80s, talk radio was just beginning. If you're of a certain generation, a radio is a little box with turn dials and speakers that often doubled as our clocks, alarms, and in some decadent cases, our answering machines. Mind-blowing, I know. Beginning in 1981, a small business entrepreneur named Bruce Williams hosted a three-hour call-in radio program originally titled TalkNet, later renamed The Bruce Williams Show. I was 12 years old, and for over a decade, five nights a week for three solid hours, I would be captivated listening to him dispense wisdom, ranging from buying a home or opening a business to creating a will and investing an inheritance. Think Dave Ramsey meets Shark Tank meets Dr. Phil. Other kids my age were more likely listening to ABBA, Styx, and Devo, while yours truly absorbed 15 hours a week of The Bruce Williams Show. Perhaps I was the inspiration for Alex P. Keaton and didn't even know it. Google it. Over the years, I listened to thousands of Bruce's episodes as guests shared their business, legal, family, or educational challenges, and Bruce advised them on their options and how he thought they should proceed. It was the single most formative educational experience of my life. Years later, I find Bruce remains the most influential mentor in my life, more than any relative, leader, priest, or professor. I learned about incorporating a business, all the types of insurances you needed and didn't, how to secure a mortgage, when to use an attorney, and when not to, and a seemingly endless set of life scenarios, many of which, if not all, I've come to face in the 40-plus years since I first started being mentored by my friend, Bruce. I've never met Bruce Williams or had a conversation with him. He passed away in 2019, and yet he was absolutely my mentor, a master mentor, to be more precise. My hope in authoring this second volume is to present such master mentors to you and invite you to enter a similar type of relationship with any or all 30 of the individuals I featured. Make that 60 if you've not yet read Volume 1. If the transformational insights from the people I highlight resonate with you, take another step and learn more about them. Buy and read their books, follow their blogs, or subscribe to their newsletters. Connect with them on social media and send them an email or message. I know them all, most very well, and they'd love to hear from you because just like you and me, they were mentored by someone, likely many, who challenged them to pay it forward in some way. I am very proud of this volume and the mentors I've featured here. As I mentioned earlier, the first criteria for being included in the Master Mentor series is that they needed to appear as a guest on FranklinCovey's On Leadership with Scott Miller podcast, now the world's largest weekly leadership podcast. Second, they needed to share an insight I deemed transformational and then agreed to be featured in the book. It's no small task to corral 30 famed leaders from around the world. But to each of them, I am grateful for their collaboration and willingness to be featured here. Thanks to them, this volume includes some life-changing stories and insights from such mentors as Zafar Masood, a relatable business leader from Pakistan, until the commercial plane he was in crashed, killing everyone on board except him and one other. Now he teaches us to find our purpose and contribution. Or Bobby Herrera, entrepreneur and author of The Gift of Struggle. I dare you to make it through this chapter without tearing or choking up and committing to make others feel seen. Or perhaps Sean Covey, an author whose books have sold over 10 million copies and who reminds us of the subtle but profound differences between self-worth, self-esteem, and self-confidence. Or perhaps Tiffany Alice, the renowned financial expert and author of Get Good with Money. Surprise, this master mentor teaches us insights far more valuable than how to improve our credit score, like how to build and sustain an enduring brand. Or Taria Pitt, someone living a normal life just like you and me, until she wasn't. Burned in a horrific fire in Australia, Taria teaches us the life-altering humility associated with being willing to ask for and accept help. There's also Patrick Bet David, the author of Your Next Five Moves. He's Persian by birth and Californian by luck. Patrick's transformational insight has the power to not only change your current mindset, but your entire professional trajectory. Or finally, Ed Milette, my favorite interview in nearly 250 On Leadership podcast episodes. You will laugh, you will cry, you will never forget reading this chapter in Ed's hilariously relatable story about headlights and the power of Velcro will change your life. Be warned, you're likely to fall in love with Ed Milette. And that's just a sample. There are 24 more master mentors featured in Volume 2, each with a transformational insight that may just be the thing to change your life, get you unstuck, shift your paradigm, or inspire you to take on that next great thing in your life. So enjoy the 30 new master mentors, and while you're at it, maybe read or even reread Volume 1. Because Volume 3 will be here sooner than you can make it through the archived episodes of The Bruce Williams Show. Master Mentor number 31, Zafar Masood. Zafar Masood, what's next? On May 22nd, 2020, PIA Flight 8303 bounced off the runway in Karachi, Pakistan. Its landing gear undeployed. Flames erupted under the damaged engines as they roared back to life, struggling to provide adequate lift. For Zafar Massoud, sitting in seat 1C, the next few minutes would have life-altering consequences. The 50-year-old CEO of the Bank of Punjab had boarded what was one of the first flights after officials had reinstated global air travel following the early pandemic hiatus. Zafar was at the peak of his professional career, helping to navigate the onset of COVID-19 and the massive changes affecting hundreds of his employees. He'd arrived early enough to the airport to switch his seat from the window to the aisle, as was his preference. Before long, the Airbus A320 left the Iqbal International Airport with 91 passengers and 8 crew members aboard. Zafar had settled into his seat in the forward cabin. The short flight from Lahore to Karachi should have been routine. But on its final approach, an hour and a half later, the pilots failed to lower the landing gear. The aircraft bounced 3 times, the engines now critically damaged. From his seat in the first row, Zafar could clearly recognize panic in the flight attendant's eyes. The aircraft climbed and began to circle, but there was a sudden jerk that caused the cockpit door to fly open. From his vantage point, Zafar could see into the plane's cabin, and through the cockpit windows, he saw they were nosediving. As Zafar recounted to me in his remarkable On Leadership interview, he discovered in that harrowing moment a sense of peace as his life opened up to him like a canvas. If it was his time to go, he had no regrets about how he'd conducted his life. The airplane tragically fell short of the runway and crashed into a residential area. Incredibly, Zafar's seat broke free from the aircraft, and beyond all logic and possibility, he landed upright on the roof of a building, unconscious but still belted into his seat. He then slid down the roof, flying off the edge and miraculously landing, again upright, on a parked car's hood. The impact blew out the windshield of the car, which happened to be occupied by 2 local residents on their way to work that morning. Completely disoriented, the car's occupants exited their vehicle only to realize there was a man sitting in a plane seat on the front of their car, alive. That Zafar has no memory of this is a small mercy amid such a tremendous tragedy. The frenzy of the crash was all-consuming to those in the area as fire quickly closed in on Zafar and others in the densely occupied Karachi neighborhood. Thankfully, a gate, later described as being always locked, was open. Zafar was carried to a waiting ambulance and taken to a hospital where his long recovery began. Tragically, all but 2 on board perished in this unspeakable horror, for which we can only wish their surviving family and friends some modicum of peace in their memory. Additionally, the carnage of this crash took many lives on the ground as well, and we honor their lives and legacies. Many thought leaders describe their moments of epiphany as being like insights falling from the heavens. Zafar's was far too literal, and it came at great personal cost to him and all those affected by the tragedy that day. So, what is to be learned from such a tragedy? So what do you do after you've survived a commercial plane crash, coping not only with your own grief, but with a deep and pervasive sense of survivor's guilt over being only 1 of 2 who actually survived? How do you reconcile the incomprehensible chain of events that had to occur to even survive such an ordeal? And perhaps most importantly, what do you do next? What do you do with a second chance? After nearly 2 years of physical, mental, and emotional recovery, Zafar shared his transformational insight during his On Leadership interview, which was a renewed focus on his family and faith, but also a measurably greater sense of empathy in both his personal and professional life. Although Zafar had developed an empathetic style of leadership during his career, he'd been somewhat tentative about it. But after the love and support he received during his recovery, it became clear to him that a human-centered approach mattered most going forward. When he eventually returned to his duties as CEO of the Bank of Punjab, he oriented his entire leadership approach around a level of caring and compassion that builds lasting connections. Safar now calls this management by empathy, and he is deeply committed to sharing these principles with other leaders around the world.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.